Okay, so we are talking about marketing stories instead of products. And actually, I think it's quite a provocative title for itself. By the way, I didn't invented it. It is taken from other people who think that this is what marketing is becoming more and more. But when you read it, when I read it, I say, really? What do you mean we don't have to put product to the market anymore? We don't have to have distribution? We don't have to promote products? Of course not. But what it is trying to tell us is that maybe one of the biggest factors to successfully market products is to know how to tell stories. How to tell good stories, relevant stories, insightful stories about what we are offering our customers. So this presentation will be answering those questions. First, what are good stories? How can good stories be relevant to marketing? How effective can it be? How relevant can this be to my business, your business? Because usually what we think, what most marketers think, yes, if you're Google, if you're Nike, if you're Adidas, you can tell good stories. You have the budget, you have the time, you have the resources. So everybody thinks telling stories or doing great marketing is good for them. I cannot do it. I don't have the time, I don't have the money, I don't have the right audience, I don't have this. So what I would like to share with you is that any of us can do it. Whatever we have a small coffee shop, wherever we have a small retailer, network, anything, and I will start with more big stories because maybe it's more fun, but as long as we go along with the presentation, we will come to more and more tactical, promotional, lower scale stories that I think any one of us can create and should create. So the first half will be understanding the big pictures of storytelling and having some insights about the kinds of storytelling we can do. The second half, after the coffee, we will enter more into details of how to create good stories and more the executional, technical briefing part. What should we understand? How should we brief? In order that we will have great stories at the end. Right. So, yeah. Freeze. There we go. So, storytelling is not new. Storytelling is part of human civilization since the very beginning, and anthropologists and scientists and everybody tells us, and we understand that stories in the core of the human nature. It's one of our prime means for communication. So it's not to tell you, hey, storytelling is a new thing. It exists since people exist. And on the other hand, also brand telling their stories exist almost since the beginning of branding. Looking into Google last week, realized that there were brands who were telling stories since the middle of the 19th century, when printed advertising started to circulate. So this is also not new. So what is new? Why today it is so different than before? And maybe to answer this question, we should ask another question, which is, who is the biggest media owner these days? Who is that? Is it Google? Yeah? Is it Apple? I don't know. Is it Facebook? Is it CNN? Is it Microsoft? And apparently, no, none of them. The biggest media owner is us. We, with our mobiles, with our Facebook groups, people are the biggest media owner. People have the majority of the content which is created and circulated around the world. People create it, you and me, when we SMS, when we write a blog, when we have a chat, and when we tweet. So we are the biggest media owner, and that's the biggest change. And it means many great things, and I will not tell you, I'm not a technological person, and I will not tell you a story about technology, but it means that first, the biggest media owner is a free media. We don't have to pay for this. When you have a good story to tell, you tell it and nobody charges you anything. So we have the possibility to use this biggest media owner for free. And of course, not only for free. So those, of course, we had a training with the media initiative. So of course, we will still need budgets to use paid media, and I'm not saying it's not important, it's highly important, but we will see that good stories circulate seamlessly from one channel to another, from paid media to non-paid, from television to the internet, and vice versa, from the internet to television. But first of all, media is highly democratized these days, meaning that it is up to people, whereas 20 years ago, or 10 years ago, I don't know when, media, you had to have a lot of money in order to brainwash people with what you thought they should think and buy and believe and so on. So it was not democratized, because if you had the money, you could circulate ideas. Today, it's changing completely. People circulate ideas only if they like it. If they don't like it, you don't have a story. You have a story that you tell, but nobody's listening and nobody's sharing. So this is one big change. Another big change is a term that was coined, I heard it very recently. It is called slow media. Whereas, again, sometime before, people didn't have any span of attention, and you needed really to catch their attention with a lot of, you know, tricks and so on. Because television is expensive, people don't have time. Slow media refers to, because we own the media, we can use the media whenever we want it, wherever we want it, however we want it, we can take it easy. And people take their time and they go to YouTube, and something that they like, they spend 20 minutes watching a TED conference, or being on Facebook with, they don't have time for commercials and they don't have time for boring stories, but something that like them, they find the time for it. When they want, on the train, at home, on the metro, airplane, wherever. So people consume, and when the content is relevant, when the stories are relevant, they have the time to do it. And that's a huge shift that is universal, is not depending if you are Korean, Japanese, American, or Romanian. This is how we relate to media these days. So what is storytelling marketing? And I find an interesting quote, again, quite provocative. People don't buy products or service, they buy stories, Adam Scott tells us. And I think it's quite an idea who makes you reflect, oh, really? Really, they don't buy product, they buy stories. Is it so? Here is an interesting caricature that I also found in Google some time ago. And I think it's the whole story in 20 words. And daddy is telling a good story for their kids. The brand is new and it's improved. It's now 50% more claims than the leading brand. Consumer lived happily ever after. How do you respond when you hear such a story? boring. Mommy, take that away. Yet, can we avoid the almost uncontrollable impulse that we have to tell people what a great brand they have? And it really requires kinds of, what kind of communication do we like? Be honest with yourself and ask yourself, with which person you prefer to go to a restaurant? Okay? Imagine you have the choice to have a coffee, to have a drink, with somebody who always talks about himself and is telling, I'm so strong, I'm so improved, I kill my competitors whenever I meet them, and I'm the best thing that you should ever have. Do you like to go to have coffee? Do you like such friends? So why do we behave in this way when we use the media? Why we always talk about ourselves? Why brands are so obsessed with talking about their attributes and their ego building? If we hate such people, why do we create such brands? Okay? So it means if we don't like to have coffee with such people, why do we create people believe that our brands is those people that we don't like? So it's quite a reflection. More than that, here's another quote who tell us that we need to move. And I would actually say we are already moving. The world is already moving. Marketing is already moving from a model or from a world where we market to people, where we are marketing to people to one, where people are marketing to each other on our behalf. So because people are the biggest media owner and people are the freest way to circulate ideas, instead of bothering them with boring information, why don't we use them in order to market on our behalf? That's the challenge. And this is what we are going to try to do, to see how we can do it. And I want to tell you one way of defining a storytelling marketing. It's definitely not the only one. There are many different ways to define, but I like this observation and definition, which storytelling marketing are stories which have high entertainment value. Very important, entertainment, because if it's not entertaining, you don't want to share somebody. And utility. Utility is also very important. Utility, it means it has some value for the people. Okay? Not only physical value, not only mechanical, instrumental value, but it has some utility to look at life differently, to have some relief from the stress of life or some new perspective to look about life. So there are endless ways to create utility and value for people, but good stories are those who are able to entertain us and to give us some value or some utility, and not less important, where we want it, how we want it, when we want it. And when it is done in that way, they create brand versations. And now, what is brand versation? I didn't invent it, but I like it, so I use it quite a lot. Branded related conversations. And which means, and I will leave it here because I think the stories will prove this idea, we have the possibilities to create stories which are not brand centric, are not focused about the brand, yet when somebody tells the story, the brand is part of the story. So when he tells the story, he's telling the brand story. And this is how it works. So let's see how it is done. And the first question that may come to mind, I don't know what are your question, but where do we start to look for stories? what is the source that we are using? And the source are manifold, but I would say basically, and from my experience, the biggest source for good stories, except unlimited inspiration, creativity, connection to everything around us, are the ability to articulate brand ideas, and this is your task as marketing, and the ability to reveal insights, consumer-related insights, and the combination of what's the brand idea and what kind of insight do I have, this is the source of good stories. So I'll try to share with you stories, but also to try to indicate to you where did they come from? What was the insight, the initial spark that enabled the story to come? And the first story, the first case I want to share with you is a very recent one. It's coming from a Thai mobile operator called TrueMove H. And they are, I looked in Google, I didn't know them before. They're one of the competitors on the Thai market. And they are usually, and looking back in their history, their advertising used to be almost like everyone else. You know, we have a great package for business and we have a very low prepaid for students. And they and some time ago, they went into some change, apparently, and they realized that, hey, we are talking to Thai people. They are very, you know, digital savvy. They want to grow, they want to succeed, but they come from a tradition, and Thailand is a highly Buddhist country, 90-something percent, really big majority, and they are not, their religion is quite cultural. So like everywhere else, I don't know how many of them are really, you know, for example, I practice meditation, Buddhist meditation, but most Thai people never tried meditation. But for them, Buddhism is a set of beliefs, set of values, set of rituals, and one fundamental thing in all Buddhist countries, in all Buddhist culture, is the idea of generosity. Generosity is highly and strongly embedded in the Thai culture through Buddhism. And you have a nice quote of the Buddha there, if you can read it. But anyway, they are educated from young age that to be generous is a way to be happy. So in a certain way, and they are educated and they are like this. And you see monks going on the streets in Thailand, even today in Bangkok, and people on their way to work, they prepare rice at home and some curry, and they go, and on the way to work, high business people, they open, they give monks food to eat, and they drive to work. So donation, generosity is part of the culture. And of course, I wouldn't say it's the main thing, but it is there. And they, at a certain moment, the brand decided, hey, this is what we want to talk. And they created a new brand idea. Giving is the best communication. And the story I'm going to show you is, according to what they said, is based on stories that they read and they listened to in social networks, social media. So take a look. Lights, please.
จัดไปอ้าวสั่งมาเรื่องต่ออะไร Amazing, huh? I see it. Can't avoid having tears each time I see it. And it's interesting. It's a three minute spot. It's long, so you cannot put it much on TV. But the trick is that either you don't put it on TV at all. I'll show you some cases that there were no TV there at all. Or you put it on TV once, and then people start to talk about it, and then it's on YouTube and on the website. Anyway, within one time screening on TV and the rest on YouTube, they had in Thailand, within 1 week, 13 million views. 13 million views doesn't happen like this. They happen because somebody sees it, and he likes it, and he shares it with somebody else. And somebody else says, yeah, well, that's an amazing story. I'll share it with somebody else. So here is how we get, almost for free, they paid. It's not a low production. But we get a story circulated around because it touches. Another example I want to share with you, not yet, just when there is a TV, for Axe. Axe was telling stories for years, usually quite sexist kind of stories where men are so irresistible and women are so stupid that they just smell it and they like magnet. And for a certain time, those kind of stories worked. But apparently in the States, they didn't work so well. American women took it quite as an offense. And the agency was, together with the client, with Unilever, were thinking, well, what other kind of stories we can tell? Almost everything about attraction and about irresistibility and about temptation, everything was told. And then, so they looked for people, men, and they asked themselves, okay, we have our success stories when we try to meet girls or women, but we also had failures in the past, didn't we? And actually, when you talk to men, and men, I want you to talk to yourself now and reflect about it, and women, I want you also to, because I think from the one hand it is gender related, but I think the insight is so strong that it crosses genders. And reflect, was it sometime in your life, maybe when you were young, maybe when you were adult, more adult, that you felt deeply in love with somebody, romantically or modern romantically, but you just didn't have the courage to go to that person and to talk to him or her? I just saw this campaign, I said, wow, that's my story. How many times I fell virtually in love, I was completely in love with somebody, I was too shy to tell her. So they spotted this insight, which I think is really universal, and they said, let's term this girl that you really loved and you were too afraid to approach her, let's term her Susan Glenn. So they took a phenomena which happened to every one of us and they transformed it into a label. They called this label Susan Glenn. And they started to prepare the background of the Susan Glenn story. And so they put it in Wikipedia, they put it in everywhere, and they ask people to start to reflect, who was your Susan Glenn? It looks like they're approaching men, but you will see later on, because the insight is so strong, that they actually approached quite a lot of women also. Okay? Because women, maybe they did not have their Susan Glenn, but women want to be Susan Glenn. And that's interesting. And they dream about being somebody else's Susan Glenn. And then they created a story. And then the brand idea became that if you have Axe, you can fear no Susan Glenn. Okay, that's how the brand is inserted. Take a look.
More than 25 years, Axe has been telling memorable stories about the power guys can have over girls. But in the U.S., that story started to become associated with, how should we put it, a certain type of guy. So we thought, why not change the story from the power guys have over girls to the power the girl can have over each of us? And her name was Susan Glenn. We started online by seeding unbranded memes defining Susan Glenn. Whoever she was, it was clear to guys what she represented. Not just a girl, but the girl. The one that blows you away so completely you never muster up the courage to approach her. The memes started to spread organically, which we fueled through cross-promotions on MTV and Spike TV. Then, with interest peaking, Axe took credit for the whole phenomenon with a single film.
I remember her. Not a girl, but the girl. The brains behind the all-time top 10 comic book vixens only wish they could conjure a siren the likes of Susan Glenn. Beneath my feet, my own private earthquake registered an 8 when Susan Glenn was near. In her presence, all that was beautiful before she arrived turned grotesque, and in her shadow, others became goblin-esque. If she approached, Susan Glenn didn't walk. She floated, accompanied by pyrotechnic spectacles that left me feeling a foot tall. She embodied every desirable quality I'd ever wanted. In my mind, I was a peasant before a queen. And so Susan Glenn and I were never a thing. If I could do it again, I'd do it differently.
The film got the world talking. Everyone could relate to the girl that got away, and no one could believe it was coming from Axe. Other celebrities and comedians started fessing up. It inspired a documentary about a guy traveling cross-country to serenade his own Susan Glenn. It even led to a web series featuring Max Greenfield from New Girl. With the term firmly planted in pop culture, it was time for guys to start declaring their own Susan Glenns. Through Facebook Connect, a mobile and online experience allowed guys to virtually take over Times Square, replacing every ad on every billboard, taxi top, and bus shelter with romantic messages declaring their very own Susan Glenn. These newly crowned Susan Glenns were able to explore and take photos of their visit to share on Facebook. This even led to a banner campaign featuring the real girls that wanted to share their excitement about receiving the honor. The world was infatuated with Susan Glenn. Guys were happy to admit they had one, and girls were eager to admit they wanted to be one. Now, only one question remained. Was Susan Glenn charming enough to turn around the brand's sales numbers? Indeed. Not only did she help beat the brand's Q4 numbers, she ended up beating their numbers for the entire year, proving anything is possible when you fear no Susan Glenn.
Next story, I think many of you are familiar with it. You are? So maybe we'll skip it?
No?
Okay. Interesting. Interestingly enough, some years ago, when they realized that the Olympics in London is going to be, of course, a big, big media event, and P&G, which I think, maybe correct me if I'm wrong, was never before associated with the Olympics, somebody came up with the idea, hey, maybe there's some interest for us. We are maybe the biggest promoter, not to offend anybody from Unilever. Anybody from Unilever here?
Yes.
Yeah? Is it true that P&G is still bigger than Unilever, or it's not true anymore? I don't know. I used to think, but we saw how Unilever is doing well, so now we have to see how P&G is doing well. So anyway, yeah, the Olympics, you know, all the eyes will be there, all the attention, all the dramas, all the emotions. How can we play there? But with Huggies, with toilet detergent, with soaps, with cleaning powders, what's P&G has to do with the Olympics? And so on the face of it, it looks no connection. But when you go deeper and you look not in at the Olympics as a media story, but you ask yourself, who is actually the heroes in the Olympics? And you say, it's people, it's athletes, it's young men, young women, and they all have a mother. Hey, that stands to be interesting. Those guys, they were not born athletes. They were born kids, and they were raised by somebody, and they were taken care by somebody. And this somebody is our dearest client. So here's an insight. Behind every successful athlete, there is a mother who took so much time, energy, emotions, effort to grow him or her up. And she is so, so proud of him now that he's an athlete and now that he's hopefully in London. So we can all connect it very quickly. And it is just what it requires when we do a training on insights is to stop thinking about the brand, but to think about consumers as human beings, not as consumers. When we look at people as consumers, we are stuck because we are fixated to the function that we give to them. They consume us. But people are not consumers. People are human beings. They also consume sometime, okay? But we are people. So here's a great insight, and here's what they did with it. Lights, please. Amazing is how such an emotional story for a huge umbrella of brands, how it translates into personal stories and consequently to sales. So what were the results? Can this campaign influence results, marketing results? Can it sell? In America only, they took this idea, this great story, and they leverage it into a digital platform in all point of contacts in America, where they give people the opportunity to thank their mom, because this is what this story is about. Thank you, mom. And we are a proud sponsor of moms. We are not proud sponsor of the Olympics. We are proud sponsor of mom, which enable the Olympics to happen. So they created this platform of Say Thank You, Mom, and people could have the opportunity to say thank you, to share their own personal thank you. And the results, only in the US, of this TV spot and the digital implementation is that it is the most successful creative
campaign for PNG in all their history, and it translated to plus 200 million incremental sales only in the US. Amazing. Sounds really amazing. So what's, when you look at, in my computer it's supposed to be, so this is blue, but here, it's not blue here, right? Okay. It's my eyes? No, it's not blue. It's gray, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, but the film was okay. You saw colors, right? Yeah. Okay. So what I want to share with you is four kind, or I don't want to say genre, but kinds of storytelling. And the first one that we have seen is a created story. It is those stories, those three stories, the true, the story about the generosity in Thailand, the story about Susan Glenn, the story about the moms, they were 100% created by the brand. Of course, it was based on insight. Of course, it had to be related and touching people so people can connect, so it was not completely fictitious, but it was stories created by the brand. And we create the story, and it's a classical story. It has a beginning, middle, end. There is a protagonist, there is an antagonist, there is drama. Good story, we let it to the people, they see it, and they have a story to tell. So this is the first kind. I think this is the oldest and the most classical, and it still works, but it's not the only one. And I want to show you with you some other ways to create stories, not entering really into the thought behind it, which will be the second part, but another way to circulate story, create and circulate stories. Intel and Toshiba. Imagine that you worked for Intel and Toshiba and you had to create a great story for Intel and Toshiba. Wow, so boring, technological. What is Intel at all? It's a process that we never see it. We don't know what is it. Everybody talks about, what's the hell? It's a bacteria, it's something that, what's, so how you create an emotional story for a brand which people have no emotion towards. You can't even say if you love it or hate it, okay? It's even better to be Microsoft that everybody loves to hate because at least there is some emotion, okay? But Intel and Toshiba, the same. Good brands, good, it's good quality thing, but people are not connected. There is awareness, there is knowledge. Probably people think that they are good brands. But how can you have some connection to such big technological monsters? So the challenge was to find a way to create a meaningful story for those brands. And they started to do a research, and I think this is one of the more, I wouldn't say deep, because I don't think there is a dimension of depth in insight, but I would say it's more sophisticated. It's not something that you see on the face of it. So they use some high potent research tools to look what are millennials, the target audience, who are they? What make them, what define them? What make them different? And how can we approach those millennials? And everybody, we all go through a journey in life of self-exploration. When we are young, we don't have really the sense of self is almost automatically there when we are very young. Don't enter into it. But when we grow up, when we become teenager, and then we ask, who are we really? And then we go into a process of self-exploration, self-discovery.
And so this is not new. This is from the time I think people are, there is this journey. But what is interesting about millennials is that unlike previous generation, where people had the urge to find quite quickly who they are, and once they find who they are, they stick to it. I am this. I am the professor of mathematics in the Bucharest University. This is who I am. I am a thinker. I am a musician. I'm nobody. But we have this, and people got this quite early in the past and stick to that self-identity. What is interesting about millennials, they find in the research, that they are not so urgent to discover quickly who they are. They go from one and they change their persona according to situations. They behave with one friend in one way. Offline they behave in one way. Online they behave in a different way. When they go to work they behave in kind of way. And they feel quite confident in having different personas in different situations. They don't need to be the same person everywhere. I think it's not, when we look at it, we say, yeah, but I'm the same. At work I'm serious, but at home with the kids I'm playful, and at the bar with, but we still, it's all of us. We have it, thank God, we are not really fixated, but the sense of who we really are is more flexible for those people, and they don't have, apparently they don't have a problem with it. They feel okay. I can be like this here and completely different in another situation. So that's the insight that they find, and they say, okay, how can we connect it to what Intel and Toshiba want to tell us? They wanted to promote a new notebook by Toshiba with Intel's strong processor inside. Intel is almost the same. It's doing amazing things, but you never see it. Okay? Sometimes it's like this, sometimes like this. Hey. So they created, based on this, they created a concept which they called the beauty inside. And the beauty inside was a framework of a story that they didn't even have completely, but they said there would be a hero, a protagonist, and we would name it Alex. And Alex is a usual guy, but at a certain moment in his life, he has this kind of disease that happened that you forget who you are. I think I only know it through Alzheimer. I mean, not personally, but I know that there is Alzheimer. But maybe there is some other. So this Alex will have a difficulty in each time. It will be Alex, but he will be a different persona because he doesn't remember himself yesterday. So they had this core of a story, and then what they did is they invited us, the world, to tell us what's the story of Alex. So anybody, you and me, especially if we are young, if we are in the millennia group age, people were advised, invited to send their own stories. And you can become the Alex, because one day he's like this, one day he's a man, one day he's a woman, one day he's old, one day he's young. So people for the first time had the possibility to star in a big production, which will become a series of episodes broadcasted mainly offline, but maybe also some online, digitally, but maybe also on TV. And if you don't have a good story, maybe just send us your picture and maybe we can insert your picture in the story. So people send quite a lot, and look what was the result.
This is the strange story of Alex, a man who wakes up every day in a different body. And for a while, that was okay. Alex kept a daily record of his odd life on his computer, which accompanied him everywhere he went. One day, though, Alex fell in love. And that is when everything changed. How could he have a relationship if he always looked different on the outside?
Yeah, I never had a girlfriend.
Well, I had girlfriends. A lot of girlfriends. Each one only for a night.
The Beauty Inside, inspired by Intel Inside, featuring the Toshiba Ultrabook, starring Topher Grace, Mary Elizabeth Winstead, and the audience. The movie was aired in 6 weekly episodes, and because Alex looked different every day, anyone in the audience could play him and be featured in the film. Each episode contained a few webcam diaries in which real fans actually wrote and acted out some of Alex's most intimate moments in the movie.
I called her 3 times today. I hung up every time.
And in the end, the audience helped give Alex hundreds of faces. This love story by 2 technology companies reached 70 million views. It got strangers discussing their own sense of identity. All while celebrating the fact that it's what's inside that counts.
She was right. I would see her again. But she would never see me.
And this is the bottom line marketing results. You see, this story doesn't tell you anything directly about Intel or Toshiba. It doesn't tell you we are faster, we are stronger, we are. But for the first time, I think ever, Intel exists many years, and as Israelis, we have a strong contact to Intel because they have a big development center in Israel. For the first time, people started to have some more deeper relations towards the brand, not because there is a good story. And when they tell the story, Intel is there. And the result, as you can see, is 360% increase in sales in the following weeks of the campaign. When was the last time that you had an increase in sale of 100%, 200%, 300%? Okay, when you launch a new product, you have it. But when the product is there, wow, amazing. I'm going quickly because we are running out of time and I talk more than I wanted, more than I thought I would. So the second kind of storytelling is that we co-create the story with people. And we do a very smart thing because they are the media owners. Okay, so if you have a joint venture with the media owner, usually it's cheaper, isn't it? Right? He have an interest to spread the story around. So people are a big resource for us. And I could show you 1 hour of campaigns co-created, but you understand the idea. People are there. They are, as a group, they are not less creative than us. How can we use them to create better story, more relevant story, which touch them more and which will facilitate the process of conveying the story around? But there are, am I shouting too much?
No?
I'm shouting to myself. Is it okay like this? Okay. There is more ways to create stories than the traditional drama-like romantic stories, where we have been so far. And we don't need to rely necessarily on a film, on a video, which is a very good way to, but what I want to share, there are other ways to do it. So let's take a look of a completely different approach of storytelling, which comes from Brazil. You know this?
Yes.
If everybody knows this, I will be very happy to skip it and to go to the next thing. So I will not show you the video, but I'll just tell you, I'll just make you aware of the fact that this story is based on one of the big inner conflicts that we have, regardless of sex, I would say. It is more edgy for women at a certain age, but I would say it's a human insight, which is this conflict that we have between the wish to be beautiful, to feel beautiful, and the self-criticism inside us who tell us we are not good enough. The nose is not straight, it's going like this. There is not enough hair here. There is some points here, which I don't want. So this self-criticism habit is a big enemy inside us. And it is a distortion to reality. And what they wanted to say is that, hey guys, don't believe yourself, believe others, because they are more objective.
I'm a forensic artist. Worked for the San Jose Police Department from 1995 to 2011.
I showed up to a place I'd never been, and there was a guy with a drafting board.
We couldn't see them, they couldn't see us.
Tell me about your hair.
I didn't know what he was doing, but then I could tell after several questions that he was drawing me.
Tell me about your chin.
It kind of protrudes a little bit, especially when I smile.
Your jaw?
My mom told me I had a big jaw.
What would be your most prominent feature?
I kind of have a fat, rounder face.
The older I've gotten, the more freckles I've gotten.
I would say I have a pretty big forehead.
Once I get a sketch, I say thank you very much, and then they leave. I don't see them.
All I had been told before the sketch was to get friendly with this other woman, Chloe.
Today I'm gonna ask you some questions about a person you met earlier, and I'm gonna ask you some general questions about their face.
She was thin, so you could see her cheekbones. And her chin, it was a nice, thin chin.
She had nice eyes. They lit up when she spoke.
Cute nose.
She had blue eyes, very nice blue eyes.
So here we are. This is the sketch that you helped me create. And that's a sketch that somebody described of you.
So yeah, that's... She looks closed off and fatter, sadder too. Mm-hmm. The second one looks more open, friendly, and happy. Mm-hmm. I should be more grateful of my natural beauty. It impacts the choices and the friends that we make, the jobs we apply for, how we treat our children. It impacts everything. I couldn't be more critical to your happiness.
Do you think you're more beautiful than you say?
Yeah. Yeah.
We spend a lot of time as women analyzing and trying to fix the things that aren't quite right. And we should spend more time appreciating the things that we do like.
So actually, what they did here is they didn't start with a story, they started with an experiment. They had an assumption, they had an insight, what I just told you, and they said, let's try to experiment it with somebody who doesn't know who you are, and who received the story, he doesn't see you, he's a great drawer, and he receives you, and you tell him how you look, and other people who know you, they tell you how you look, and they compare. And this experiment was transformed, was videoed, and the result is that it was launched in Brazil in March, and up to date, it got last week a big award in the US, I think 170 million views. I think it was not meant to be a viral, of course they hoped it would be, but it's the most successful marketing viral ever. 170 million views up to date. Big contrast, we move from emotional storytelling into other ways to tell stories which not necessarily have to be highly emotional, and sometimes they can be quite different. And this is a story for a respected, very respected Philharmonic Orchestra in Dortmund, in Germany. And they saw that less and less people come to classical music, and they had problems because they couldn't have an financial balance. You know, most orchestras doesn't make a huge profit, but still, it's Germany, it's Dortmund. So they approached an agency to try to help them to bring more people who usually doesn't go to concerts, so a new clientele. And the agency had a very unusual approach to it. And they told him, you know, it's funny because there is this belief, people believe that if babies listen to classical music, and scientists also proven it, and also if animals listen to classical music, they perform better. You know, this baby Mozart, baby Beethoven, and so on. That people believe in it, and there are scientific evidence. Let's put it to a try. Let's really try to see if it works. And our idea to you is take your respected orchestra and go to farms and play classical music to cows, and then milk those cows, and then brand the cow, the milk, as the concert milk, and sell it to the people so that they can taste the milk and see, is there a difference between regular milk and milk made from cows, listen to your music. They came to the respected client, you know, German, and this is what you should do to increase sales. What would you do if somebody, you would be the responsible, and this agency would come to you with this crazy idea? How many of you would say, yes, go, do it, it's a good idea? Hands up, those who would say, I think it's a good idea. I'm not sure I would, okay? But okay, there are some people here. Okay, great. Luckily enough, the client understood how communication worked these days. And he understood that it's all about a good story. If we have a good story to tell, it will tell by itself. And by the way, they didn't have budget for media, some production and so on. So the client approved it, and let's see what happened.
Life isn't easy for Dortmund Concert Hall, located between concrete buildings and kebab shops in the Ruhr Valley, where hardly anyone is interested in classical music. But we found a way to make classical music attractive to all of these people with a basic food product, with milk. Scientists have proven that cows produce more milk when they listen to classical music. So, we let the cows listen to the new season's artists. First, we held a live concert to give them time to become accustomed to this new situation. Then we exposed them to recordings of selected artists. The cows no longer produced ordinary milk, they made the taste of music. Sip by sip, artist by artist. In cooperation with selected specialty shops, we introduced Dortmund concert milk to the market. Every bottle provided additional information about the artist and the concert hall season. Concert milk tasted good, and not only to the people of Dortmund. Bloggers visited the cows on the farm and taste-tested the milk. It became local and national news. With our milk, we attracted a whole new audience with no previous interest in classical music. And because of it, Dortmund Concert Hall had financially its most successful season of all time. The number of subscribers rose by more than 19%. The average house capacity rose to 72%, and this was well before the end of the season.
I just want to draw your attention on the term that we used before, brand versations, okay? They created a good story. And people had the ability to share this story, to tell it. There's a good story to tell. And once they told the story about those strange ideas, people who play classical music to cows, and then they milk them, and then we buy it and we taste it, they told the story of the orchestra. So it created an interest. Which kind of orchestra do you want to listen? Those who play boring music or those who have great ideas? Okay, so the result was amazing. And I also want to draw your attention that those kind of ideas, it takes usually more than 2 days to produce and to create. So if your marketing is about, I need something from today on tomorrow, and most people, this is how they behave, they don't think, they don't plan, they always react to what happened, and I'm not blaming anything, you will not be able to create good stories, because you will only be able to create stressful stories because you are in stress. But if you want to have impact, and because when you sell optical devices and when you sell yogurts, it takes some time to develop those products, right? You don't produce them overnight. Once there is the line of production, it takes seconds, but to set it all in motion, because stories are so important of our marketing, they could be, we have to understand that it takes some time to create it. This idea, you can come up with this idea in half an hour brainstorming session, but it will take you time to produce it. And if you don't have the time, you will just not necessarily have good stories. Before I continue, I want to ask, I saw the list of people. Are there people here from banks sector? Yes? Okay. So I'll share with you a story of a bank. And I think banking is quite challenging because apparently banks, insurance, so boring. We just have money and loans and credits and interest. Is there a story to tell about banking that can really engage people? And that was the challenge that a bank in Australia faced 2 years ago. Yeah, we've seen this. And the bank is one of the four leading banks, NAB, North Australia Bank, four leading banks in Australia. And the problem they face, and I think it's not only unique to Australia, is that the perception in Australia is that the four big banks coordinate rates and interest between them, and that there is no real competition. And although the NAB for 2 years, 2 years prior to this idea, they were really trying to differentiate themselves by giving really advantageous products and services, nobody believed them. They still the perception that in Australia they call it the bankers go to bed together. They are married to each other. They go, that's what the Australian way of saying. And they thought, well, how can we break it? What can we do? And of course, they knew that they don't do it. There is no really coordination, and it's not the case, but this is what people believe. And they said, then they brainstormed, and they said, well, the only way to break it and make people believe us is to admit it. Admit that we go to bed, that we are married. Once we admit that we are married, and then we say we break up, then they would believe us, because until now they didn't believe us because we didn't accept that we went to bed. So they had a very interesting story. They leaked a tweet that a big executive in the bank, in the NAB bank, wrote to some other banker, where he's saying, listen, I had enough from you, I break up. And they made people believe that it was a mistake, that it was not meant to be discovered, but somebody discovered it. And then the whole nation started to talk, hey, you see, we have a proof, they go to bed together. And the day after, when everybody accepted it, then they say, okay, we now officially break. And you see what an amazing story they created.
The public, if you think about it, believe that there's been collusion between the banks, that they simply follow each other with all their fees, that there's been no real competition between them.
But this all actually started on Friday with what looked like an accidental tweet from a NAB employee. It read, "So stressed out, have to make a tough decision, and I know I'll probably hurt someone's feeling,
But well, no one likes to receive a Dear John letter announcing a breakup, especially when it's published in the papers for the world to see.
The NAB has written an open letter.
A relationship breakup letter.
Dear CommBank, ANZ and Westpac.
Honestly, it isn't you, it's me.
This letter today is astonishing, Wendy.
I can't be around you anymore. Enjoy your ride.
Oh, yeah, right. Good riddance.
Nowhere was safe from the blitz by the newly single NAB. NAB's launching a full-scale attack on its competitors.
The NAB is telling its rivals their relationship is over. There was even a piano man singing broken love songs outside the ANZ headquarters.
The sky, the street and the net were all bombarded with messages of breakup.
This is the biggest thing we've seen in banking for a long, long time.
The other three big banks are filthy, absolutely livid with the NAB right now.
Consumers stand to save tens of millions of dollars.
This has got to be good for Australia.
Sincerely, NAB.
So even banks can create good stories and circulate them. So the third kind of storytelling is actually not to create a story, but to do something in reality. And this act that we are doing, either with the milk or with the experiment on women and painting, or with the breakup idea, what our act becomes a story for people to share. Because the act itself is so unusual and so unpredictable and surprising, people share it. It's a good story to tell. So we do something, and what we do becomes a story for people to share. But there's another way to do it. And I want to show you some examples. And this is a case from South Africa, and it's a beer brand. Carling Black Label is one of the biggest brands in South Africa, and traditionally they sponsor the one of the biggest clubs in the Premier League. And of course, beer and football goes together very well, you know that. So the brief was to increase level of engagement between the brand and a sport fan, kind of a sponsorship, but they wanted to do it in a different way. And so they thought, what is meaningful for people, for sport fans? What do they care about? What frustrates them? And you can find quite a lot of things if you're a football lover. A lot of things frustrate you. And one of the things that frustrates football fans in Australia is coming from the fact that some of the coaches of the Premier League clubs, they come from overseas. They got Germans, Netherlands, Brazil, Serbia. And although they are very good coaches in and for themselves, yet football fans in South Africa believe that those foreigners, they don't understand the local mentality. They don't understand the South African spirit. And because they don't understand it, they cannot be the best coach for my team. And actually, when you dig deeper, those fans believe, you know, I could do it better. I know my team better. I could be a better coach. Sounds familiar to you? Right. So they decided to do something with it. And actually, why not give an opportunity the first time ever for fans to literally be the coach for their own teams? So they came up with this idea, which was called Be the Coach. And they organized for this a one-off competition between the two best clubs in the Premier League, and sponsored by the brand Carling Black Label. And in this competition, it was the first time where football fans could vote and decide before the game who would be the 11 players. So they created a mobile application. South Africa is not so strong in internet. The best communication, interactive thing is mobile, a very simple mobile, not even smartphone. But the application allow anybody to choose the best 11 players he or she wants, probably he, but who knows. And those people, those players who would be voted the most would be the players, and not even that. So no coaches, you are the coach. People are the coach. Not only that, during the game, in the halftime, people could decide and vote who would substitute whom and whom. So it was fully a full game coached by the people. Take a look.
South African men
love two things, soccer and Carling Black Label. It's South Africa's biggest beer. And when soccer fans crack open a Carling Black Label and watch a game, chances are they're watching Kaizer Chiefs and Orlando Pirates. They're South Africa's biggest soccer clubs. But Carling Black Label noticed that the fans were getting more and more frustrated with the coaches. The coaches were coming from foreign countries like Brazil and Serbia, and they weren't as connected with the local flavor of South African soccer. The fans believed they knew their soccer clubs better than the coaches. All South African fans needed was a chance to prove themselves. So Carling Black Label gave the power to South African fans by creating the Carling Black Label Cup. The fans could pick the players for their team. The fans could make a live substitution on the day of the game. For the first time in football history, the fans could literally be the coach. We launched the campaign in TV, press, radio and online with Dutch coach Ruud Gullit. Soccer fans immediately began voting for the players they wanted in the team by using the unique code under the cap of their Carling Black Label. The only thing a fan needed to cast a vote and become a coach was the one thing South African fans already had, a cell phone. We designed and built a unique mobile platform that gave the fans a chance to vote for the players they wanted. We built a website where fans could see their teams and share it on Facebook and Twitter. After 7 weeks of intense voting, the teams were announced, as selected by South African fans. The campaign ignited fierce debate in the media between fans, purists, players, and journalists. Even the coaches got involved. One thing wasn't up for debate. South African soccer fans loved the idea. We received over 10.5 million votes in 7 weeks. Tickets for the historic match set new records, with over 85,000 fans attending and millions more watching on TV. The Carling Black Label Facebook page grew by 450%. Our following on Twitter grew by 600%. Over 83 million rands worth of PR was generated for Carling Black Label. The game itself couldn't have played out better. The first Carling Black Label Cup was decided in a dramatic
penalty shootout. He's thinking about where he's going to place it. Orlando Pirates have won the inaugural Carling Black Label Cup.
And even though Orlando Pirates won and Kaizer Chiefs lost, South African fans all celebrated their own victory because, thanks to the Carling Black Label Cup, they finally had the chance to be the coach.
The next case is coming from an insurance company in Netherlands, and they sell maybe the most hardest product to sell, funeral insurance. What kind of story you can tell about funeral insurance, and apparently never been buried, and never buried anybody in Netherlands, thank God. But apparently it's quite expensive. They don't have a lot of land in, so it's very expensive. And they have a special insurance for this. And then they thought, well, how can we market such a product as a policy against death and insurance for funeral? And again, they started to talk, to think about people. What people, what insights, what dilemmas, what conflicts people have regarding death and death of loved one. And they came up with a very interesting observation. And it happens quite a lot when somebody dies, that after he dies, we say great words about him. You know, he was so kind, he was so humble, he was so generous, he always cared about others. And sometimes we have this feeling, wow, if he knew all what we think about it, maybe he wouldn't die. You know this? Yeah? So they say, hey, that's something. How can we use this to create a story? And they created a story, rather a platform than a story, where they call it, why wait before it's too late? Until it's too late. Say something wonderful now. And they invited Dutch people, young, old, to say nice things to their dear ones now. That was the idea. And the brand was just behind this idea. And they launched it with some quite emotional video clips that they gathered. But you'll see what a clever media and engagement idea they came up with.
If you could say anything to him now, but you only had a short time to say it, what would you say to him?
I really wish I could spend more time with you. Around, yet she can't seem to turn them around. She can't seem to turn them around. And I'm really glad that you were my dad.
When a loved one passes, we say such beautiful things. Words we wish we could still say to them. So Dela, a funeral insurance company, started an initiative. Why wait until it's too late? Say something wonderful today. People were given the chance to surprise someone they really care about. Using hidden cameras, we documented their speeches and used them in commercials and for online documentaries.
Ik wil graag iets opdragen aan mijn lieve ouders die hier zitten. Bedankt, mama en pap, dat jullie je leven in Iran hebben achtergelaten voor mij. Om mij een leven te kunnen bieden waar ik altijd van heb gedroomd. En waarvan ik nooit had gedacht dat het werkelijkheid zou worden. Ik wil jullie heel erg bedanken voor jullie moed en jullie doorzettingsvermogen. En voor alles wat jullie voor mij hebben gedaan.
Pa, ik wil je bedanken voor de mooie jaren hier. En dat niet alleen. Ik ben nu een aantal maanden getrouwd en je hebt mij enorm geholpen met klussen. Eigenlijk sta je altijd voor me klaar. Pa, ik zeg het niet vaak, maar ik hou van je.
Je bent een super zoon in moeilijke tijden en in gewone tijden. Dank je wel, lieve jongen.
Waarom zou je eigenlijk wachten met iemand bedanken als het ook nu kan?
Het geld doet me voor de rest niks, maar als ik dit zo'n bedankje krijg, dan ja, vind ik het fantastisch.
We also created newspaper ads with just one word, dear. People were inspired to fill in the rest to show their love. They could upload these thoughts on our special website. Using the messages written on the ads, we created outdoor posters. Each poster was unique and personal, and displayed locally, where the person it was intended for could see it. We took over a TV channel for an evening, so people could broadcast their love, live on television. People don't want to think about death, but this campaign made them realize even more what life is about.
For the first time ever, a funeral insurance company achieved a position among the top 10 best-known brands in the Netherlands. The amount of insured capital grew by 50%. But more importantly, Holland became a little more loving, thanks to our message. Why wait until it's too late? Say something wonderful today.
So a big move from insurance companies. Oh my God. Yeah, that's good. To smartphones. AT&T, one of the biggest mobile carriers or mobile providers in the US, is competing very hard and tough against competitors to sell more smartphones. And the competition is really huge in America, because not only you compete against your direct competitors, T-Mobile and the others, but also you compete against dealers who sell smartphones regardless of the network that you have. And when they thought, how could we sell more smartphones? Usually, correct me if I'm wrong, when companies sell smartphones, they put emphasis, and for youth, big target audience, they put emphasis on what great installment and what great services, and they are the first to sell iPhone 5, and they are the first to sell the HTC One, and so on. And most of the communication is on the product level. What great product, what great installment, and so on. But when you talk to youngsters, actually you don't have to convince them. They know about the product before you advertise it. They read about it in blogs, in newspapers, in technological things, in Facebook. And the problem for them is not to convince them that they want it. The problem for them is their parents who buy it for them. Most of the time, before you're 18, 19, you don't have the money to buy it. So your task is not to get excited about the phone. You are excited already. How do you convince your parents that you deserve a new phone? And I know it very well for myself, because I have those fights with my kids. Oh, no, you're too young, you don't need, we just bought it 2 years ago, and so on. So they said, the barrier is parents. And we have to, if we want to be successful, we have to help teenagers to convince their parents. Which is not easy, because how can you do it? And usually when there is conflict, a good way to solve conflict, not the only way, is to use humor. Humor breaks the ice. So they decided, they came up with the idea of creating a platform, a Facebook platform, where another person, who is a slick lawyer, an actor, will pledge for yourself, for your parents, on your behalf. And they called the idea, You've Got a Case. So they created this profile and this personality of this lawyer. It's the famous, Will Arnett, American player. And the application, if you wanted to use the application, you had to allow them to grab all your Facebook profile. And this personal profile, teenagers don't care so much about sharing their profile, they are there anyway. This application used your profile to create a personalized video clip where the guy is pledging on your behalf from your gift giver. So you would name the gift giver, it's my mother, my father, my uncle, and why you deserve a cell phone, and what's all the stories in your life that allow you to claim that you want a new smartphone. And then the kids could send this video to their parents or share it and to joke about it. Let's see what happened.
Question. How can AT&T help young people prove to their parents they deserve a new 4G smartphone?
Don't answer that question. Let your new lawyer take over.
Introducing You've Got a Case, a digital experience that gives young people access to their very own Facebook attorney.
Hi, come on in. I'm powerful internet attorney Kent Wesley. You know that, you're in my office. I think you deserve the AT&T 4G smartphone of your holiday dreams. But first, you need to grab me a tiny peek at your Facebook profile. Don't worry, it won't get creepy. I probably could have made it less creepy by blinking once or twice during all of that.
The campaign launched with a flurry of promotional ads. Banners, Facebook ads, tweets, classifieds, and pre-roll.
Kent Wesley, high-powered internet attorney. And these are just some of the pants I've sued off people.
All roads lead to Kent's stately Facebook office, where you select the smartphone you want, name your gift giver, and litigate.
Ladies and gentlemen of Facebook, my legal team has prepared a case proving my client deserves a smartphone from their mom.
Every case gets a random combination of expert witnesses who all testify on your behalf, incorporating your friends, your favorite movies, your school, everything into a customized plea. Your airtight argument posts directly to your defendant's wall, pleading your case before a jury of your Facebook peers.
Do you believe that my client deserves a holiday gift that will make them popular? A gift more or less personally endorsed by an actual star who's asked me to invest in his independent film? No, by the way, no, I won't. You just got served. Kent Wesley rests.
2 second recess.
You've Got a Case was a social and commercial success. It leveraged everything about Facebook into a way to sell phones. The entire campaign was an appeal from one Facebook user to another, so shareability was built in. Nearly 500,000 people consulted Kent. Click-through rates to purchase were up to 5 times greater than the benchmark, and we nailed our demographic. Over half of Kent's clients were 13 to 24. AT&T's 4G smartphone sales boomed, marking a record quarter. It was also a landmark in the mobile category, the first project ever that allowed users to generate and view personalized Facebook videos entirely from mobile devices. The results were almost as dramatic as Kent.
But aren't we all just scared little girls?
Case dismissed.
The verdict was unanimous.
Mark that as a W.
If you've got Kent Wesley, you've got a case.
And the only thing I can't win is a losing contest.
So the fourth kind is not you do something, but you make people do something. And while people doing this thing, they have a new story to sell. So again, another approach, instead of telling a story, instead of co-creating a story with people, instead of acting, why not make people act, make them do something, and they have a good story to tell. And it's more personalized and more touching than everything else. So, four kinds of way of storytelling, but now we want to know how can we create it. We move to the second part, which is more about how do we do it. And, what's that? Yeah. So how do we technically, tactically execute those stories? We'll skip this case, not because it's not great, but just because we don't have time. I'll show you this one. And this is a very interesting case because it's very insightful and it's very funny, I think, very successful. For Puma in Europe, Puma, you know, is a small player, is a challenger. They have the tenth of the budget that Adidas and Nike, each one of them has. So they are a small player, but still they want to win business. And their brand idea prior to this story was Puma equal love. Puma equal love, and their target audience is a sports fan, football fans, mainly in this case. And for those fans, football is love. Why do we cherish our team? It's an act of love. And people love football and fans. But they noticed, so they advertised this concept, that on that year, Valentine's Day, which is the love day, falls on a Sunday, which is the match day in Europe, and they understood that their audience, their consumers, going to have a personal, emotional dilemma. What do you do on Sunday, which is Valentine's Day? Do you take your girlfriend or wife for coffee, you buy her chocolate and flowers, and you tell her how much you love her? Or you do what you really want to do, go with your mates to the game and watch your favorite team. So, hey, guys, our core target audience going to have a dilemma. And a dilemma which is on our brand idea, football equals love. What do we do? How can we help them? So first, and I don't think they needed research, they realized that the big majority of football fans would decide to go to the football. unfortunately for the women, but that's the truth of life. So they say, how can we help them? How can we help them to excuse themselves? And actually they thought, well, maybe we can explain that the fact that they love football doesn't mean that they don't love their loved one. It just means that they love football. So again, touching an emotional conflict between him and her through humor. So they decided to create an e-card, a digital personalized e-card that they would send it to the people, and people, very humoristic, those people would be able to sign it personally and send it to their loved one. And you'll see it is for me the most creative and funny e-card ever created. The e-card was a song, but sung by the most surprising love song ever, Hooligans of Football, singing a love song that people could dedicate at the end and send to their loved ones. So take a look. That's the idea, okay, but here it is.
I'll be your dream, I'll be your wish, I'll be your fantasy.
I'll be your hope, I'll be your love, be everything that you need.
I love you more with every breath, truly, madly, deeply do. I will be strong, I will be faithful, cause I'm counting on a new beginning. A reason for living, a deeper meaning. I wanna stand with you on a mountain. I wanna bathe with you in the sea. I wanna lay like this forever, until the sky falls down on me.
And when the stars are shining brightly in the velvet sky, I'll make a wish, send it to heaven, then make you wanna cry. The tears of joy for all the pleasure and the certainty that we're surrounded by the comfort and protection of the highest power. In lonely hours, the tears devour you. I wanna stand with you on a mountain. I wanna play with you in the sea. I wanna lay like this forever, until the sky falls down on me.
So they did this, and they started to spread it virally. They don't have a big budget, but people loved it so much, and they shared it like crazy. They shared it not only with their girlfriend and wives, but also with friends, because when you are a good mate, you send it, they should also use it. I'm not the only one. So shareability was amazing. Only in the UK they launched this. In the UK, in Germany, in Italy, and in France, each country their own love song. I showed you the English version. More than that, they, in the match day, on Valentine's Day, they created karaoke stands outside the stadiums where fans could go and record themselves singing their own hardcore song, whatever they wanted, and send it from the match to their girlfriends, wives, telling them, you know, we are in the match and we watch our team, but we still love you. And results were amazing. Only in the UK, more than 12 million shares within 10 days, amazing. And which led to amazing results. Online sales of Puma went in more than 500% following this campaign, amazing. Now, you may wonder, Puma is a very small part of the story. They don't talk about Puma. They talk about people, and they give something meaningful for people to do. And what's the trick here? How can we make great stories which are not centered about us and yet at the end of the day have such a great results? So the trick, I'm challenging you now to think, we have the be the coach idea, we have the Della story, say something before it's too late, we have the hardcore Spuma idea. What do they share in common? What would you say is the common trick here? Now we really come down to earth. What can we create in order to have a good story sharing? Can you find some common things? In what way those three ideas are different from straightforward advertising? Please.
The focus is on human emotion.
Right. Yes, but completely true. More than that, please.
Engagement.
Involvement. Yes, they are highly involved. Again, what else?
Relationships.
Please?
Relationships,
yes. This is all true, but where is the focus? Is the focus on the brand or is it on something else? It's not on the brand. So what is this something else?
People.
I agree, but I would suggest to you one more way to look at it. We call this approach fight for a cause, this tool. Fight for a cause, it means that first, what is a cause? Just to make, I know that you have the word causa in, but what we mean by a cause is an idea or a goal which people, which is common to many people, and people would like to transform it, to realize it, to change something in order to obtain that idea, to obtain that goal. So a cause is an idea that people are ready to do something in order to realize it, okay? So here we are not focusing on the brand. Rather, through the insight that we have, we create a cause, we create this idea, and we present this cause to the people, and people, because they are it touched something, it is meaningful for them, they are rallying in the cause, they participate, they are engaged because they want to change something in order to do something better in their life. And this thing can be many things, we will see. But again, the main focus is not on the brand, it is on the cause, okay? Then what we do is we create the platforms, the media platforms, for people to engage with the cause. And people engage with the cause because, again, it matters to them. They want to be the coach. They want to convince their loved one that they still have her, although they go to the game. They want to express for their family the fact that they care about them now, not after they did. Okay? So the cause is meaningful for the people. It's not focused on the brand. It's focused about something that matters for the people. The beautiful thing is that although the focus is not on the brand, at the end of the day, the sympathy and the awareness and the emotions that people have for the cause is reflected back on the brand, because the brand helps them to do something or to achieve something which is meaningful for them. Very small, just say I love you, just express my emotions, just give me the possibility to participate in choosing the best 11 team. But at the end of the day, they thank the brand because the brand cares about them. The brand is more touching their hearts and mind. So that's the thing, okay? And as you probably know, it is much easier. People, they don't like to talk about brands. And when brands tell them, do this or believe me and things, it's not a story that we want to share. But if the brand doesn't focus about itself, but suggest a cause, then I can freely and much more easily engage with the cause because I don't suspect it to be for some commercial reason. It touched me. As you said, it is connected to some emotion, to some frustration, to some love or hate or desire or need that people have. It's much easier to relate. Okay? They don't say buy it and your life will be better. It's not the equation. It's something that is meaningful for you. If you do something that is meaningful for you, you love the brand behind it because they help you to do it. Okay? So this is one technique of creating a story, and actually it's the last one, is the kind of story where people do something and this doing of something becomes their story and they share it. Okay? Are we clear about it? I want to show you yet another technique, and this is very tactical, promotional, low-key, low-budget, but yet amazing. Coming from Australia, for a producer of food products, meat pies. Meat pies is typically Australian dish. People who love to eat it are men during lunchtime, usually blue-collar working people, you know, constructors and blue-collar. But they love it, but the problem is that although they love it and it's tasty and it's full of energy and so on, and it's meat, and women don't like it so much in Australia. Why? Because they think it's not really healthy. There's just minced meat baked, conserved in a pie, not so healthy. So they realized that they have a problem. The consumers, the users like it, but the women who purchase it for them doesn't like it. What do they do? Who do they support? Do they change the product so that women believe it's more healthy, but then men may not like it as before? Or do they give a tool for men to help them to convince the woman? And they brainstormed about it, and they came up with the idea, with the help of their agency, to do this. They came up with the idea of what they called a magic salad plate. The magic salad plate is just a plastic plate where the salad is just printed on the plate, and when you eat it together with the meat pie, you make the impression to others as if you're having a healthy lunch. So just a joke. And as you remember, when there is a conflict, joke is good to break the ice. And they produced it. They produced thousands of plastic meat pies, and they sold them in the supermarkets and in the point of purchase next to the product. You didn't have to buy it together, but you could buy the product and the meat pie and the salad. And they launched it with a 30-second TV commercial and some outdoor and some internet. You'll see the TV commercial.
Despite the fact it's been practically proven a salad's useless, some people, like the ladies, seem to think that you should at least look like you're trying. That's why we at 4&20 have developed this, the Magic Salad Plate. To the untrained eye, it appears you're having a salad, but really it's just part of the plate. Here's how it works.
Look, Sue, those guys are having salad with their pies. Let's give them our phone numbers.
It's a scientific miracle. Have a lunch that's edible on a plate that's credible. The 4&20 Magic Salad Plate.
So just a small story to tell, a good joke to share with your mates, to share with your wife, and the result, sales boomed. Not only they sold all the salad plates that they have in 2 weeks, but increase of sales of the core product, of the meat pie, increased in 40% for the singles, 21% in the four pie. Huge, amazing marketing result without any product innovation and product change. So when you think about those cases, I showed you some of them before the break, the milk, concert milk, the you've got a case with this Facebook platform to pledge a phone from your parents, and the magic salad plate. They're very different. Each one of them is a different category, different solution, different market, different idea, yet they share something in common. What would you say is the common trick here?
Surprise.
Surprise. Definitely it's something surprising, but where do the surprise come from?
An accessory to the product.
Yes, say it louder.
An accessory to the product.
What? Accessory, agree completely. What is accessory to the product?
The case in case of the
Yeah.
And the plate, the major plate.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. We call it, and actually what it is create a new product or a new service. And that's quite interesting because instead of advertising your core product or core service, think what is the message that you want to communicate. And then once you are clear about what's the message, instead of advertising the message, ask yourself what kind of a new product or a new service we can create that once people will be exposed to this new product or service, the core message will be delivered. Okay, so that's another trick. And the creation of a new product, okay, once through the exposure to the new product, the awareness of the core brand, the core message is being reinforced. And why it is interesting, again, many times, most of the time, we don't have a product innovation. There is nothing new about the product. It's the same concert now and last year and next year, same product. It's the same meat pies that we sell for 20 years. Nothing to innovate there at the moment. Sometimes we do have. But how can we create a new story around it and surprising and innovative? And then the idea is define clearly what's the message that you want to communicate. What's the problem that you want to address in the communication? And then think, what kind of a product or a service, product meaning it's plate, a new kind of milk, or a service like a lawyer who is helping you to pledge for your smartphone, we can launch to the market not as a profit center. It's not a new product. It's not a brand extension. It's not a profit center. It is that the new product or service is just a tactical tool to create awareness about the core product. Okay? And it's funny because people are not used. People drink milk every day, but it's the first time that they drink milk made by cows who listen to classical music. Hey, we have a good story to tell. People use a lot of plates every day, plus, but the first time they eat a plate from a plate where the salad is printed on the plate. People buy a lot of cell phones and use cell phones, but the first time there is a new service of a personal lawyer for you can free, for free he can pledge to you to help to convince parents. So it's very interesting. It happens in reality. It's not just a story which the company tells you, but it's in reality. It's you do something, you interact with something, and this something helps you to understand what the brand is about. Is it clear? Okay. How much time do we still have? I just want to know.
15 minutes.
15 minutes? Is it okay with you, 15 minutes? And then some dialogue questions and so on. Okay, so where shall we go? What is longer and what is younger? This is 10, this is 15, 20. So we'll skip this one. Excuse me, I'll just run faster. Oh, that's so nice. That's okay, we are here. Okay, are there any car dealers here? People who market cars? Not anybody? But everybody drives a car. Okay, at least this. So we have a new product launch in Belgium a few years ago, and this is for brand Dodge. Dodge was launched in Belgium 2 years previous to this campaign, and the positioning of Dodge in Belgium was macho car. It was kind of a car, strong, powerful for men, and they positioned macho as a macho brand. 2 years later, they started to market a new model of Dodge Journey, which is a family car, bigger SUV vehicle, and they had a problem. We targeted men, singles, macho in the beginning. That's the positioning of Dodge in Belgium. Now we have a family car. How can we successfully market a family car without losing the positioning of a macho? And they came to the client with this idea. You want to do some promotion, you want to promote the car, you want to invite people to test drive the car. How about this promotion? People will be invited to the showroom, and couples, that's the target audience, and they will be able to test drive the car, but why not give them the opportunity to test their ability to make love in the car, in the dealership, in central place in the capital. But why should they do it? We have to give them a good incentive. And the incentive said was that the couple who can prove that they made love in the car, the first baby who would be born, that the, for the parents who could prove that they made it in the car, these parents will get the car for free. So we have a new kind of promotion. Prove to us that you can make love in the car and you'll get the car for free. Crazy or no? Really crazy.
How they prove that?
So you'll see that there is here, you'll see in the video, you'll see here they have, they call it a baby predictor. It was some kind of device that people went to the showroom, to the car, couples, they made love, they used the predictor. I don't know how it worked, I can only imagine. It has maybe the sperm was on it, I don't know. But they had it, some digital tester that you actually made love and not only, because they didn't film it. And they had to give the thing, and they advertised it. The client was courageous. You need to be courageous to approve such an idea. But the client was also smart. He or she or they understood that it is such a good story that there will be nobody in the market who will not hear about it. It's a great story to tell. So they launched it. They said, okay, go, produce it. And then they went to production. And actually the budget was very tiny. The only budget they had was to have banners on the internet and to have e-cards. That was all. They had some money for radio and they did one billboard, but actually it was purely digital campaign. And then when they started to work on it, they said, well, it would be quite easy to convince the guys to go with their girlfriend or wife and test drive the car and make love in the car. Why not? If you can get a free Dodge at the end, guys would go. But how would you convince a woman to go with her husband or with her boyfriend to a public place to make love in a car? Of course, nobody sees, but still it's not your home. And only for the chances that he, 9 months later, would drive a new Dodge. How? Which women would come? So they thought, how we could convince women to come? They realized that this is the weak part of the equation. And then somebody had the insight, I don't know if it's true elsewhere, but at least they say in Belgium it is so, that if you're a woman and your boyfriend tells you that he's ready to make
we'll be right back.
Alexander, zo snel al. We maken wel meer kans als we samenkomen, hè.
Zo'n coole Dodge.
Ah, ik heb een kind gemaakt met mijn vrouw.
Ah, dus als ik een kind maak met uw vrouw, dan krijg ik een Dodge.
Ja, hallo. Bereid je gezin uit in de nieuwe Dodge Journey tijdens de Baby Made on Board Days op 14 en 15 juni en win een Dodge Journey. Meer info op babymadeonboard.be of bij uw Dodge concessiehouder. Dodge. Grab life.
Story I want to share with you, the one before the last one, is a quite recent launch of the Galaxy S4 in Switzerland earlier this year. And if you know the Galaxy S4, one of the attributes, one of the functionalities of this mobile phone, that it can recognize if you look at him. If you look at the smartphone, then he opens itself for you, you don't have to think. So this is one of the attributes they wanted to promote. And it's quite nice, but how do you do it? How you can create a good story out of the fact that your phone is looking at you? So they challenged the agency, and the agency came up with this idea. Some incentive to to people to buy the phone. And actually, the biggest reward here was to get a smartphone. That's all. I don't know how much it cost. Several hundred of euros, probably, maybe a bit more. But how can you create a story where not only people are invited to participate, but they have a great story to tell? Okay, so what's the trick here? How they transform a very banal promotion into an unforgettable story? So think about the Dodge, think about this one, and the last case I want to show you is this one. Maybe one of the more, without anybody offending, I hope, one of the most boring things is to sell car insurance. Not so easy, right? In Australia, my partner tells that, how come Australians are so creative? And his thought is, well, they are in the other part of the world, so they always stand upside down, so probably they're thinking different, so that's why they have so much good creative ideas. But anyway, an agency was challenged to create a good story about an insurance company who, for the first time in Australia, offered a policy of insurance, usually in normal insurance in Australia, only the driver and his wife are insured to drive the car. And when you want other people to drive, you pay extra insurance. But they, for the first time, had one policy without any extras. Anybody can drive. That was the message. It's nice, right? Nice. But how can you create a good story? So the agency came up with the following story. They decided to give the car, a car, small mini Polo car, for free for one young driver with one small condition. For 3 weeks, this guy has to drive the car all over Australia, but he's not allowed to drive himself. He should invite other people to drive the car for him. To make the story more interesting and more hard, they placed three cameras inside the car, so viewers on the website can see online who is driving the car and what's going on inside, what's the story. And to make it even more interesting, they had a website and they had joint connection with some radio station and bloggers, so any Australian could follow the journey on Google Maps and on Foursquare, and you'll see, and call the guy and tell him, I need to go from Sydney to Melbourne, from Bucharest to Ploiești, whatever. I need to be there tomorrow, come and take me. So he had to find somebody who would drive the car for this guy. So it was a big thing for him, but the whole nation followed it and people could use him. And they advertise it also in television. Take a look.
Hi, I'm Tom, and this is the story of what I had to do to get a new car for free. Because in the real world, people lend their friends their cars, NRMA decided to do what no other insurer in the country does, start insuring anyone who drives your car. And to prove it, they gave me this car, with one little catch. I had to share it with the rest of Australia. All they needed to do was flag me down and hop behind the wheel. Unfortunately, people had no trouble finding out where I was, as my position was constantly updated through Google Maps, Facebook Places, and my Twitter account. I was plugged into radio stations where I kept people up to date with my whereabouts, and if there was something happening, I was there.
Tom is heading to Hornsby, and the Salvo is hitting the Lower North Shore by Crows Nest and North Sydney. So if you'd like to drive his car, find out where to find him, go to this website, nrma.com.au.
The other thing was, my car was rigged up with three cameras, and the content they generated became our national TV campaign. NRMA insurance cover anyone who drives a car, even if they're not nominated. And to prove it, they gave me this, as long as I shared it with the rest of Australia.
What? Stop here. One, two, three.
So for insurance that actually insures you, visit NRMA Insurance or call 132 132. The activation was supported by EDMs, direct mail, posters, and a Facebook competition, where people could win a car just by choosing the friends they would want to share it with. I had a whole bunch of random people driving my car, but hey, at least I got a car out of it, so it was sort of worth it.
but I want to sit on Santa's lap. Well, you're not sitting on his lap, you stand next to him.
I don't really want to be associated with one of your exes, to be honest, so...
Oh, no one wants to be associated with...
I think.
And the results? In the first 9 weeks, we had almost 2 million web visits, over 300,000 sales calls, and over 1 million people visit our branches. That's more than 1 in every 7 Australians. And with a conversion rate of 24%, that's over 800,000 policies.
Amazing, huh? What a simple idea. Actually, it's simple. It doesn't look simple in the beginning. What kind of effect it can have on sales? Do you see the results of sales? How much new insurances they sold? What was the impact nationwide? Good story to tell. So what's the pattern here? When you think about this baby made on board idea, when you think about this smartphone, all eyes on the four, on the S4, and my car is yours, what's the common trick here?
Challenge,
exactly. What kind of challenge?
Hard one.
Hard one, very hard one, exactly. We call it extreme challenge. And the idea here is, instead of just doing a promotion and offer something which is relevant to people, why not do something which will not only be relevant to people, but it will be very hard to do. And because we make the challenge so extreme, so unheard of before, people will have a good story. And not only people, but also the media will have a good story, because this genre of competing, of challenging, of doing something really extreme, it's like sports. It's an entertaining content because you know how it starts, but you have no idea how it's going to end. That's why you watch sport. If we knew from the very beginning who will win Chelsea against, we wouldn't watch it, right? But we don't know. So it's exciting. And this is the same here. Promotions, usually, promotion is one of the most used techniques in marketing, and promotions are good. I'm not saying it's not good, but how many times it happened to you that the promotion that you made became a news item on TV, that the whole country talked about it? Usually, those who care are those who want the product now. Okay, I get 30% off. I will buy 5 Cokes and I might win a trip to Haiti. Great. But is it a story to tell that Coke is doing it? Everybody is doing it every day. Open a newspaper and you see hundreds of promotions. So usually the story is relevant only for the person that today, and not always. But when we have a good story behind it, when we challenge people to do something unusual, so they would be challenged because they want to get something for free, but they will share it with everybody because they have a great story to tell. And this is the power of storytelling, that we can create ideas that people would share, and because it's a good story, instead of paying for the media to advertise it, the media would cover it for free because it's a great story.